أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا كتب عليكم الصيام كما كتب على الذين من قبلكم لعلكم تتقون.
Excuse me, please stay 6 feet far away from me.
Keep your seat far away from me.
Really? I'm not coming for this women gathering during the quarantine. Coronavirus is not a laughing matter.
This time we pray in our houses. It hurts us more, but we cannot allow the virus to spread. We value life above all things. That is our faith.
I wash my hands frequently with soap for at least 20 seconds. And I wear a face mask.
Listen to government orders given by science to save ourselves. Get the knowledge from Free Press, learn what is happening.
To learn more, visit www.ramsacounty.us.
Do not be afraid. The information can save your life of yours and loved ones. If they say stay at home, stay at home. Give our heroes, our doctors, nurses, nursing homes, retail workers, police, sheriffs, first responders, government agencies, and Defense Department, help. We need them to save us all. Give them a fighting chance for all our survival. We shall overcome, together, all of us.
I want to begin in the name of Allah, who is most gracious and most merciful. My task today is both difficult and challenging, because I was asked to speak on the difficulty and the challenge, and hopefully pose some ideas on how we may approach solutions to the devastation of our communities that was brought on by the COVID-19 pandemic. As we speak, Jamaica in the Caribbean has the highest number of deaths with 524. Guyana follows with 215. Suriname 176. Trinidad 140. Barbados 39. And the smaller islands with, in the tens. And then further afield, we know that more than 500,000 people have passed away in the United States. So having said that, I think I need to note from the outset that a pandemic is a once in a generation event. An event like this impacts society and normally produces change. These events change is always attached, or change always accompanies this kind of event. So this is a global event, and we are now more than ever a global society. When the 1918 Spanish flu happened, we were not yet an integrated and an interdependent global society. We have moved very quickly into this stage of interdependency, where everyone in the world, regardless of where we are, have some dependency in someone else we don't know in some far-flung area of the world. So we are all interconnected. None of us, therefore, are spared from the challenges posed by this coronavirus. This is a disease that affects the body. It is unseen. It comes from breathing in the air, the breath, the exhalation of another person. This is why masking and social distancing must be practiced as a means of combating this disease. This is a global event whose transmission therefore happens at the local level. It happens in the household, in the locality, in the village, from person to person. We cannot therefore begin to speak about a post-COVID Caribbean without reference to the world within which we live. In this sense, the term "we are all consumed," made famous by the Guyanese national poet Martin Carter, is now very pertinent. As we think about the pandemic and where we are, we have to think about what we call, what I'm calling here, the conundrum. So we must begin by talking about the conundrum. That is the level of madness, and I will call it madness. The rejection of facts, logic and rational thinking, and the expansion of conspiracy theories. This is not the first time that human society have gone through this kind of process. So this is not, nor is it going to be the last time of conspiracy theories for students of history. Muslims and Jews were rejected as normal people. At one time, Muslims are still rejected as normal people. Then non-whites were deemed to be non-humans. Women were deemed to be unequal to men, and so forth. The indigenous people were deemed to be savages. So in a post-COVID Caribbean, we have to learn to accept logic and science and reject conspiracies. What are these conspiracies? I mean, any browsing of newspapers, you see stuff like there is vaccine skepticism among Latinos. There is vaccine skepticism among Black Americans. In the indigenous communities of Guyana, there is skepticism. There is skepticism even among health workers. Missionaries are spreading fear of vaccination in some indigenous communities in the Amazon. And we can go on and on. And this is not only happening in poor countries. It is happening in France. France is now the most skeptic country in the developed world. What are these skepticisms? The virus does not exist. No, I had this conversation with a pastor who tells me it doesn't exist. No, it doesn't exist. He says the vaccine is not necessary. And if the virus exists, it will disappear on its own. That the virus is like the common cold or the common flu. It is not. But we have to rely on science. A lot of these conspiracies are spread on social media. Even populist leaders, this is a moment of populism, are spreading this kind of narrative. And community leaders in our community and some of our communities are holding on to these narratives. Who the skeptical groups are mostly? Hispanics, indigenous, poor whites, blacks, nonconformists. Some people in our communities. So we have to recognize these issues that we have, because to talk about going forward, we have to recognize the problem that we have, and we have to deal with those problems. Now, the other conundrum is, should we be vaccinated? Vaccine distribution is available unevenly across the world. I am lucky. I was able to get my second dose on Friday. So I am considered fully vaccinated. But how many people can say the same? So we have to deal with these issues, because unless we have what is called herd immunity. We're not going to see, beginning to see the end of this virus. Poor countries, the voices of poor countries are relatively absent on the fact that the vaccines is mostly available in rich countries. We should ask the question, why are the rules on vaccine patents not loosened? Why the rules are not loosened to allow for open manufacture and more flow of vaccines? And where are the voice of the leaders of poor countries? Why isn't there a resolution of the United Nations that discusses this matter publicly? COVID has exposed the structured inequalities that exist in our societies. What are these inequalities? Informational, I will first of all talk about the informational literacy deficit, which leads to education and healthcare deficits in our communities. The groups that are most affected when there is a pandemic like this have always been the historically most discriminated and marginalized groups. Peoples of color, the poor, people in former colonial countries, people with long-term health conditions. People who live in poverty, people who have diminishing life chances. Remember, I said before that the groups most affected are the historically marginalized. They're marginalized socially and economically. The elderly. People without access to generational wealth, to old money. People without higher education in our communities. These are all groups that are marginalized by something like the virus and the effect on the virus on our communities. So poverty and inequality has increased from all the statistics that we've looked at. Poverty and inequality have increased between the so-called 1%, the most rich in our communities, and the 99% in all countries. Higher paid workers, blue collar workers, are able to work from home, or most of them are able to work from home. That is white collar workers, blue collar workers, most of them who are low paid, who work in restaurants, hotels, service industries, who keep the engine of production going, they cannot work from home. Farmers and vendors still have to go to the market. And this is happening in poor countries. This kind of dislocation, the World Economic Forum has described it as a wrecking ball, as an economic wrecking ball for the poor. When we began this pandemic, the world population stood at 7.6 billion. With 820 million of that 7.6 billion suffering from extreme hunger. Another two, within that 7.6 billion though, 2 billion people suffer from what is called micronutrient deficiency, irregular access to inadequate nutrition. What is called in the literature, food insecurity. Because nutrients come from healthy food, wholesome food, organic food, not GMO produced food. So what do we do? What do we do? What is the solution? Do we as communities throw our hands up in the air and leave it up to politicians and governments and other leaders? Or do we get up, do something, and be counted? This is the stark choice. We have, as people, given over our power for too long. The answer is in community discussion, mobilization, and action. Community leaders, teachers, nurses, practitioners, religious leaders, local government need to begin to listen to the people, need to learn, implement. Development is and should be about people. But development, especially over the last 40, 50 years, have been about what the central government decides, what global agencies agreed to, what the World Bank and the IMF and the UNDP and the FAO and IFAD and others agreed to. And a lot of these projects have not arisen through discussion, through listening tours. So a lot, what we see in a lot of these countries are white elephants. And so our communities suffer as a result of projects that does not meet our needs. So what are we supposed to do? What are the action steps we need to take? We need to educate. We need to address the information hurdle. Learning from this experience that we have gone through, we have to inculcate in people at the local, at the community level, within the family structure, within our villages, within the mosque, within the churches, within the community, within the discussion groups in the community. We need to educate and inform. We need to teach people how to employ and use logic, how to learn to be rational. We have a big struggle to defeat conspiracy theories. So we have to, first of all, explain and discuss what is COVID-19. We have to explain the virus in simple to understand terms. We have to explain the long-term impact of this virus, because the virus have long-term impacts on the individual who have contracted the virus. We have to explain and discuss the vaccines in simple and easy to understand terms. Who should do this explanation? People who are trusted by community people, teachers, nurses, community leaders, mulvis, pastors, pandits. This should be a global, a regional, and more importantly, a national outreach at the community level. The imams should be able to use the pulpits on Fridays to do this work. How do we do this? We have to regain the ability, the art, to use printed material. We should produce very literate printed material or literate visual material, public service announcements, which can be distributed through text. Everybody have a cell phone, through WhatsApp, and through social media platforms. We have to fight against conspiracy theories. Where do we do this? We need to popularize it in every community, in the mosque, and in other religious gathering places, in women's groups, in schools, in community organizations. Why do we need to do that? Because we have to root out misinformation. We have to root out misinformation. Everyone should be involved in this campaign, in this approach. We have to address the healthcare deficit. This pandemic is showing us in very stark terms the healthcare deficit that exists in each of our communities. The system that exists assumes that everyone is equal. But everyone should have access, equal access to evaluation and to treatment. We have to develop community partnerships with governments, with agencies, with medical professionals, and create the mechanism to recognize the deficit so that facilities with adequate human and material resources are developed to meet community needs. We should know by now that most of our communities were not ready and were not prepared and did not have a pandemic preparedness and response plan. We can see that from the amount of testing that has been done in our communities, from the treatment and the vaccines that are available. So if we don't have that, are we ready to conduct the post-pandemic care? Remember, as I said before, there are lingering issues related to the virus. So we have to educate people on the lingering effects of the pandemic. Who should be asked to get involved? The medical schools, the medical councils, organization of medical professionals, the doctors, nurses in the communities. They should give of their time to educate the populace where they live. Here is an example of the testing deficit. I'm using this because, I mean, the last time I checked, the number of people tested in Guyana is about 75,000. Guyana have a population of about 782,000. Barbados, with a population of 287,000, by March 6th, had tested almost 130,000. Of their population. Why is that? Guyana is a country that is richer than Barbados. Why do we have that deficit? So we have to beef up the existing healthcare centers and hospitals, develop new ones in underserved communities. But we have to move beyond that. In the Caribbean, we have to recognize mental health as a disease and develop mental health infrastructure. We have to develop a community-centered approach to these things. We then have to follow. We have to beef up counseling, treatment and rehabilitation facilities to address victims of sexual and domestic violence. We have centers in some countries. Those are not enough. But we have to improve education on nutrition and preventative care. We have to improve education on the rights of women and children and develop progressive laws in the justice system to educate. The justice system must educate people. And if necessary, prosecute employers, prosecute men and fathers who exploits and abuse women and their girl children. We have to think about ways of educational, health and other institutions, how these can be strengthened in our community, in your community. These are the things that we need to think about. I talked about the nutrition deficit. This is most important. A country like Guyana, we should not have anybody suffering from malnutrition in Guyana. Guyana is supposed to be the breadbasket of the Caribbean. So why do people suffer from malnutrition? Why is Guyana moving in the direction of producing GMO-produced food rather than producing healthy, organic food and encouraging people to eat healthy? We need to encourage every family to plant a garden, to rear livestock if they're able, to learn the art of food preservation, and importantly, to take what we can eat, do not overeat, and do not waste. You know, I was sitting at my breakfast table last night at dinner, and I noticed kind of Coca-Cola. I don't drink Coca-Cola. But there is a tool at the bottom of the Coca-Cola that you can take your cell phone, take a picture, and you can check what is in the Coke. Do you know that a 12-ounce can of Coke have 39 grams of sugar? 49 grams, micrograms of sodium. A 12-ounce can of Coke contains 9.75 teaspoons of sugar, which equates to 39 grams of sugar. This is more than the American Heart Association and the medical profession recommends that adults get in an entire day. Think about that. Let that sink in. Let that sink in. Every can of Coke we consume, we are consuming as much sugar as we need as human beings. Now, how do we address these deficits? We have to go back to organizing lectures at the community level, creating discussion and discourses on issues affecting the community, encourage health education, information, and sports in sports clubs and in schools. Encourage gardens in the schools and in the communities. Work with others to encourage the development of micro enterprise projects, especially for people who are in the poverty bracket. And if needed, seek the help of professionals. We have to empower ourselves, take back our power. My intention in this presentation was to be practical. This was intentional. I designed this presentation to give you the opportunity to think about the power each of us have to make change. No governments, in any part of the world across history has ever made any change. It is people who make change. The reason why there is no change in communities is because people have given over their power to governments. We need people to take that power back. Empower yourselves. Thank you.
Assalamu alaikum. This is Mohamed from Muslim Mastery, and today I'm going to be sharing with you 7 tips to overcome any trial in your life. Tip 1. Control your tongue. True patience is at the first strike of calamity, and this is where the golden reward lies. When the son of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away, he said, "The eyes shed tears and the heart grieves, but we do not say anything except what is pleasing to Allah." Tip 2. Turn to Allah. Say, "Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un." To Allah we belong and to Him we shall return. Or, "Alhamdulillah ala kulli hal." All praises for Allah in all circumstances. The more you fill your heart with Allah over everything else, the easier Allah will make it for you to get through the trial. Tip 3. Trust in Allah's decree. Remember that Allah has decreed this trial for you, and His decree is always perfect. Allah is the all-knowing and all-wise, so He has the full picture, whereas we only see a tiny pixel. Even though you might not feel or see the good in it, trust that your trial is the best thing in the world for you at that time. Tip 4. Use this trial to get closer to Allah. Don't waste this opportunity to take your relationship with Allah to another level. Through the mercy of Allah, this trial could be a means for your sins to be forgiven and might be your ticket to Jannah. Tip 5. Be grateful. You might be thinking, be grateful for what? Remember, no matter how tough your situation is, there are always people who are worse off than you, and even your trial could have been worse. Thank Allah for the blessings that you do have. Tip 6. Take action. There is usually some physical action you can take to make the situation better. Focus on what's in your control and be proactive. If you can't think of any specific action, do more good deeds like helping others or reading the Quran. Tip 7. Make dua to Allah. Remember that Allah knows the pain you're going through and He is with you. It's vital to seek advice from righteous friends who will remind you of Allah, but rely on Allah as your ultimate source of strength and comfort. May Allah give me and you the tawfiq to implement these tips. Jazakallah khair for watching. Please click subscribe if you want more videos specially designed to empower you. Assalamu alaikum.